Good morning, everyone. My name is Badejo. I'm a senior cybersecurity at Best Buy Canada. And then part of what I do on a daily basis is part of the global threat detection team. So what that means is that I'm basically behind the desk all day, responding to alerts, be it at the stores, at the head office. So Best Buy being one of the biggest retailers in the world, we see this threat on a daily basis. So I'll be talking to you today about what we see on a daily basis, the current threats in cybersecurity, the predictions for the future, so what do we think is going to happen in the future in our field. And then I'll be sharing some key takeaways to round this up. So I hope it's interesting. So what is happening in cybersecurity? We've had the first two speakers talk about many, many things right now. How we can take advantage of the cloud, how our businesses are at risk. And then, it's not far from the truth. As you can see, the CEO of IBM said that cybercrime is the biggest threat to every business in the world. And check out the fact on the truth. Because as you can see, cybercrime and then criminals have been evolving from targeting people, computers, to start targeting things like airplanes, power grids. And then slowly and slowly, it's beginning to creep into our lives, how we live our daily lives. And then you can see that eventually, this is a problem in our daily society. Cybercrime is the biggest threat to every business in the world. So right now, we're talking about the current threats in cybersecurity, coupled with current threats as well. And as you heard earlier, phishing is a big one. The amount lost to phishing, I can't even begin to start with it, because every time you click on a link, and then it leads to something else, and then it leads to something bigger. And then from phishing, attackers have gone to something called business email compromise, which is a more targeted way of reaching people in an organization. So what we are beginning to see right now is when cyber threats have evolved, and then the trend evolving in them shows the change in which how cyber criminals are going about their attacks. So right now, we're seeing the criminals not doing what they normally do before. They are going from a large attack where they attack everyone, targeted groups of attack against businesses. So the first one would be phishing. The second one explains how the risk of phishing is going to go as high as 9 billion by 2018. But what I really want to talk about is cryptojacking and ransomware. How I'm going to explain cryptojacking and ransomware, and how they relate to each other, and how these are the current threats you're facing right now. So this is a report from IBM. This is a threat intelligence report from IBM, where you go out and talk about what's the current threat you're facing right now. And then the question I asked is cryptojacking the new ransomware? I would say, yeah, both here to say. I mean, recently we heard about the ransomware attack against one of the biggest depositories we have yet. But what I'm beginning to see, what the trends I'm beginning to see right now is that ransomware is beginning to go down. It doesn't mean it's disappearing. It just means cryptojacking is also on the rise. And cryptojacking is when an attacker uses your computing resource to begin to mine cryptocurrencies. And all of this is because of the recent boom in cryptocurrencies. And the difference between the two, if you ask me, is in ransomware, the attacker focuses on getting your attention. So if you're going to be hit with a ransomware, you basically can access your files, everything is encrypted, and you have to pay your ransom. But with cryptojacking, it's a bit different. Cryptojacking focuses on not even getting attention, it focuses on going under the radar. And what it does is it begins to use your computing resource to begin to mine cryptocurrencies. And then I begin to ask, how does this affect small and medium scale businesses? Because you might ask, okay, I don't know what's happening, my system is just running faster than it normally does. But we begin to see a direct relation to cost for small businesses. As we see small businesses moving to the cloud to take advantage of the economies of scale, scalability, to begin to do more with less, cryptocurrency and cryptojacking might have an effect. A typical example would be, if you are in the cloud right now and you get hit with cryptojacking, or you have cryptojacking in your environment right now, with the crypto malware, you really don't really see the impact. But it comes to play when you're paying for your cost, for your cloud. It begins to use your computing resource to mine cryptocurrencies. And all of a sudden, you're paying more than you usually paid before. So you're beginning to see a direct relation from cryptojacking to small and medium scale enterprises. A lot of organizations like Best Buy, we have people like me, that's what we do all day. 24/7, we sit behind, responding to these threats, getting this crypto malware from our environment. But that's not the same for small and medium scale businesses, as we've said earlier. Many of the small and medium scale businesses don't have the resource to grow up like cryptojacking. and then this malware stays in the environment, and you begin to get more help desk calls, you spend more resources on something you can't even detect. So I think this is somewhat not a bigger issue than ransomware. Ransomware is here to stay. But the trend which I see on a daily basis on my job is more and more attackers are going to cryptojacking because they see it as an easy way to pay them. I don't need to actually come into your system, disrupt your business, and tell you to pay me cryptocurrencies. If I can do that in the background while you're paying for it, I think it's a win-win. And there's also another trend in which cryptojacking is making headlines today. They're beginning to attack businesses and government organizations. So in India, for example, a couple of months ago, one of the biggest municipalities there was attacked. So what they did, because cryptojacking can affect you in two ways, let me put it that way. It can come in form of phishing attack, whereby it gets you to click on a link and then it embeds itself in your system and it goes quiet, continuing to mine using your computing resource. The other way cryptojacking can affect you is by going into a popular website and then setting some JavaScript. So I'm not going to go into details, but what it does essentially is, if we visit that site, for example, by the mere fact that we're on that site, it begins to use our computing resource. And this is why the cyber criminals are targeting government organizations, like the one in India. Millions of people visit that municipality site every single day to get information. So it just got me thinking, what happens if, for example, the city of Surrey, whereby people go to this website every day to get information, and then you notice nothing is happening, you just go to those websites to get information, and all of a sudden, by the mere fact that you're on that website, it begins to use your computer resource to mine cryptocurrency. And this is what happened in India, whereby a couple of their sites were infected, and people visit those sites on a daily basis. So they're taking advantage of the fact that they know people would go to the sites, and then their systems continue to mine cryptocurrency. So this is not something that is well known, but it's not making the headlines there, because at the end of the day, I can't see it. But eventually, it has a direct cost to your business. So I'm going to move ahead and talk about cybersecurity predictions and then what we see to happen. So right now, as we all know, cybersecurity and cybercrime is here to stay. We're not going back on that. And one of the interesting things I'd like to highlight here is something recently happened with Japan. So Japan is preparing for their 2020 Olympics. And part of what they are doing right now is they said, you know what, we need to take proactive measures to protect our citizens. So Japan right now will begin hacking their citizens, which is a very, very unique dynamic to what we are used to. So beginning February, Japan said they will take over 200 million IPs associated with their citizens and begin to find out which devices have low security and then bring out those vulnerabilities and then contact their citizens one by one, telling them, this is what you have, this is what you have. Do this to improve your security. Change your password on your router. And then this is something that got me thinking. Is this a trend? Are we beginning to see government organizations stepping up to helping their citizens in the case of Japan? And the reason why Japan took this step was because right from 2016, Japan realized that 60% of the attack against their country has been IoT attacks, which is the Internet of Things. This is a prediction of the future. Well, Internet of Things is also here to stay. And in the next couple of years, we're going to be seeing a big wave of Internet of Things, more devices connected to the Internet. And then Japan, you know, got me by surprise by taking that step and saying, okay, we would go about and then infect and then try and hack into our citizens and then make them secure that way. So it's one of the things I'm saying. So we see in the future now whereby governments begin to take action and say, okay, for example, let's hack into our citizens. What do they have? How secure are our citizens? Let's be proactive in these measures. What comes of it, I don't know, but I just felt it was an interesting thing to bring up to see if the world will follow suit in the steps of Japan. And secondly, growing cybersecurity and privacy concerns. I think this is also a big one which I mentioned earlier, with the introduction of GDPR in Europe. So we're beginning to see organizations and even companies, countries taking steps to provide to protect the privacy of our citizens. And then the big question would be, would this be a first step towards the global privacy law? GDPR is not the first one. We've had similar laws in California, even Japan and Brazil are taking steps now to protect their citizens and their privacy. So with the introduction of all these laws, what can happen in the future, what you see happening in the future is whereby a global privacy law can come to play. How that will happen, we don't know, but with the current move of cybersecurity attacks, I think we will all come together one day and say, okay, we need a global security law, we need a global privacy law. GDPR is good for, you know, other countries are beginning to form their own, but right now, I think we need a global security or privacy law. So this is what I see coming up in the future. And then the third one would be the advent of 5G network. I know this is relatively new, but this is something you're seeing in the future right now, whereby the speed of connecting to the internet is big, easy. And then we start bypassing our routers and connecting straight to the network. And all of this will continue to increase the attack surface. So in essence, it's an interesting field, but there's more to come. And then I feel we are beginning to get equipped to face the challenges we are seeing in cybersecurity. To conclude, I would say a quote from Jay Johnson, which is the former Secretary of Homeland Security in the United States. And he says, cybersecurity is a shared responsibility. And it boils down to this. Cybersecurity, in cybersecurity, the more systems we protect, the more secure we all are. And as we've all heard today, the landscape is evolving and it's getting wider and wider. So this is a call for all of us to come together and realize that cybersecurity is not a personal problem, it's not a business problem, it's everyone's problem. And then I look forward to see what we make of it in the future. Thank you.